Tanta Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Self-Care for the Real World by Nadia Narain and Katia Narain Phillips. Narrated by Nadia Narain and Katia Narain Phillips.
Introduction. What is self-care? I have come to believe that caring for myself is not self-indulgent. Caring for myself is an act of survival. Audre Lorde. At the most basic level, self-care means the ability to get yourself fed, dressed, and washed, and to generally function in the world. Everyone practices self-care, even if they're not aware of it. In this book, we want to help you learn how to turn self-care into something that is not just about functioning, but flourishing. The way we like to define self-care is learning to look after your own self as you would a child or a very dear friend, with love, kindness, and patience. We use the word caring as a compliment, yet when we talk about self-care, sometimes people assume it means only caring for oneself, regardless of the impact on others. We have even heard people say that self-care is selfish. But we believe if you feel you are the best version of yourself, you will have more to give and to contribute to the world. When we feel good about ourselves, we do better, kinder things for ourselves and for others, and we naturally let the good things in our lives grow. When we feel bad, we become more selfish and self-absorbed, and we don't have the energy to give to other people or to the things or causes we care about. Self-care can sometimes seem like it's just a hashtag for wellness influencers on Instagram. But we want you to remember that self-care isn't just for people who have hours of spare time or lots of money for expensive massages or pedicures. You don't have to put off self-care until your life is less busy, or until you've perfected your diet or bought those fancy yoga leggings. To us, self-care means being switched on, fully present, and engaged in your life. It's the opposite of switching off and retreating from the world. Ignoring your own needs leaves you depleted, but self-care will energize and recharge you. This is the real world, and there will always be demands on your time and energy. But you are deserving of a little of your time and energy just as much as anyone else around you. Self-care doesn't mean overhauling your entire life in a drastic way. Who has the time for that? It's about meeting yourself where you are right now, instead of where you think you should be, and thinking about the small steps you can take to care for yourself better. You might be surprised at how transformative just a few small steps can be. So remember, self-care is not selfish. It is all about learning self-love, self-respect, self-compassion, and seeing the impact that all of these have on your own well-being and the well-being of those around you. This book is full of the ideas that have worked for us over the years, and we hope they'll inspire you too. What is self-care to you? You probably already know the basics. Move your body, feed your body, nourish your mind and your soul. But it's important to remember that self-care is going to feel different to everyone. The best way to nail what self-care means to you is learning to know the difference between what you need rather than what you want. Getting what you want can feel superficial, whether it's the latest iPhone or a great pair of shoes. It may give you an instant buzz, but it won't sustain you long term. Getting what you need goes a little deeper. Words like nourish, nurture, resource, recharge, refuel, love, and kindness are the essence of self-care. Remind yourself of these words when you're reaching towards a want stop and ask yourself, is this nurturing me? Is this refueling me? Is this recharging me? Look for the balance. It's important to check in with everything that's going on with your life so you can get a holistic view and tweak things accordingly. Self-care will mean different things to you at different times in your life. If something big is going on, a breakup, a bereavement, a house move, you will need to take care of yourself in a kind and gentle way. If things are going well and you have some spare time and energy, the best self-care might be to challenge yourself a little. Remember, no one else's way is the right way for you. Not even our way, which is why this book is about helping you find what works for you. Taking care of yourself is not optional. Our mission is not about achieving perfection. It's about accepting you are human with all your beauty and all your flaws, accepting you deserve to be happy and well, and doing what you can when you can to get there. We know from experience that magical thinking doesn't work, and neither does blindly trying to be positive. Sometimes chanting positive affirmations when you're feeling terrible can even make you feel worse. What is most effective is learning what works for you and identifying the small, powerful changes you can make which will transform the way you feel. Learning to feel good can feel weird if you're not used to it. Maybe you have somehow learned to believe that you don't deserve to be looked after. But you do. And you are the first and best person to do it. You know what they tell you about the oxygen mask in the safety demonstration on a plane? That you have to put on yours before you put on your child's. We didn't understand that for years. But the more we learnt about self-care, the more we got it that if the parent didn't put on their mask first in an emergency, their child wouldn't survive. This is true for all kinds of things in life. If you are depleted and exhausted emotionally, physically, or mentally, you will have nothing to give anyone else. Think of it as survival of the most resilient. Right now, you may be deep in the waves of life, being tossed around. Learning self-care is like building your own lifeboat, plank by plank. Once you've got your boat, you'll still be rocked by the same waves, but you'll have a feeling of safety and a stability that means you can pick up other people on your way. Learn what you need. The first step of self-care is to pay attention. Start to listen to what your body needs and how it reacts, and you will begin to hone your intuition. Through the course of this book, the exercises we suggest will get you closer to reading and understanding your body. It's not easy, we know, when you're being bombarded with information about what you should be doing or what you should or shouldn't eat. Do you have a tendency to try something that's popular, like giving up sugar perhaps, then insist on everyone else trying it too? We used to do that. But there is no one prescription, and different things work for different people at different times. If you just do the things that other people tell you to, they may not give you the energy or relaxation you crave. Or the results won't last if your new habits are not truly in line with what you need. You may be so busy that you haven't checked in with yourself for a while. Do you really want to do a spin class after work? Or are you going because you think you should? Is a fourth coffee or tea today a habit or a necessity? If you say it's a necessity, we'll work on getting you properly rested in a later chapter. Why are you eating that family-sized bar of chocolate? For pleasure? Or did you get into a fight with someone and now there's a big empty feeling inside that you're trying to fill? We are going to teach you to read your body so that at every point you can check in and find out what is going to work. Trust us, your body knows. Our own self-care. Our own paths to self-care have been long, with plenty of detours, and we have learnt lessons the hard way. Having practiced yoga, Reiki, and massage from a young age, we got really good at looking after other people way before we learned to look after ourselves. We love lists. In Matt Haig's book, Reasons to Stay Alive, he explains how he created lists to help with his anxiety and depression. He wrote a list of things that made him feel bad and a list of things that made him feel better. As soon as we read these, we started making our own self-care lists, writing down the things that make us feel terrible and those that make us feel good and grounded. We've combined our lists because we are both pretty similar, apart from cooking, Katia's thing, and meditating. Only Nadia likes it. What's on your list? Write it down. Our non-self-care list. Too many late nights in a row. Thinking we should be somewhere other than where we are. Pretending to be anything other than ourselves. Comparing ourselves to other people. Not paying attention to our bodies. Eating too much sugar. Eating junk food. Working too much. Not practicing yoga enough. Forgetting to meditate because I've been on Instagram for too long. Zoning out to box sets, TV in general, social media in general. Not taking a day off when we need to. Missing meals. Not being around friends and family. Being around too many people for too long. Our self-care list. Making sure we get to bed by 10:30 most nights. Taking a relaxing bath or shower before bed. Preparing ahead when it comes to food so that we eat healthy and tasty things. Being around friends and family. Dancing. Going to yoga class. Meditating every day. Nadia. Doing our gratitude journals every morning and night. Being honest to ourselves about ourselves. Paying attention to self-critical thoughts and changing the track to something more positive. Treating ourselves as kindly as we treat the people we teach and feed. Taking naps and rest when needed. Walking in nature. Swimming in the sea. Having quiet time.
Love. Just for a while, be open to the possibility that there is nothing wrong with you.
Sherry Huber.
You might think loving yourself sounds a bit self-indulgent, but when you practice it fully, it puts more responsibility for your life on you and so relieves the pressure on people you love. Self-love is not narcissism or self-centeredness. It is a kindness to yourself and also to those around you. It means you won't go around looking for love in other people or things, or hoping that others will fill the emptiness you think you have inside. We can make the mistake of thinking that love only means romantic love, and that if we don't have that great romance in our life right now, it must mean we're unloved and unlovable. This is why self-love and self-care in love are a big deal. They're the type of love you can always be sure will be there for you, no matter what. Putting care and love into yourself will allow you to be more open to receiving love from others. You will find you have more to give. It's like a circle, and it starts with you. Some lucky people learn to love themselves in childhood, but the rest of us have to learn it along the way, at different stages of our life. We hope this section will help you. There is nothing wrong with you. What if I forgave myself? What if I forgave myself even though I'd done some things I shouldn't have? What if all these things I shouldn't have done were what got me here? What if I was never redeemed? What if I already was? Cheryl strayed. Just imagine, for a minute, that this statement is completely true. There is nothing wrong with you. Say it a few times, see how it feels. Weird, right? A lot of us are brought up to believe we need to be better in some way. Maybe you were told that you should get top grades at school, or maybe there was something you felt you had to achieve in order to please somebody you loved. That's fine if you got the message you were still lovable. Even if you failed the exam or got suspended from school. But if the overall message you heard from your parents or significant people around you was that love had conditions attached, it may be hard, even as an adult, to feel you're good enough. Don't get us wrong, we do believe in working hard and doing your best. But what also matters is not so much that you can be good, more that you were already born full of goodness and love. Other things that have happened to you may lead you to think there's something wrong with you. A boyfriend may have said one small thing about you when you were going out, and it stuck. Even if you haven't seen him for years, you may still feel that part of you needs to be fixed or changed. Nadia remembers her best friend in school telling her she should always wear baggy clothes and cover up her legs because they were too skinny. It was only when, as an adult, a friend asked why she always hid her body that she remembered it and realised it had stayed with her for years. So think about what early messages you absorbed about yourself. Can you begin to question those messages and ask if they are really true? Those childhood patterns stay with us, and when we are reminded of them by something that happens in the present, we often find ourselves coming back to the same ingrained message. There is something wrong with me. When something happens in adult life to confirm this, maybe criticism from a boss, or a row with a partner, or a friend, we find ourselves dragged into the painful place in our minds where we feel we are not good enough. Remember that even if you've behaved badly or have done something mean or unkind, that does not make you a terrible person. We all make mistakes. The most self-caring thing you can do right now is forgive yourself. How to make friends with your thoughts. You may have tried all kinds of ways to escape this feeling of not being good enough. People look for a magic wand to make the pain or empty feeling go away. Maybe you go shopping to feel better, or drink a lot, or have sex with people you don't like much because you want them to like you. Or perhaps you go to a tarot card reader in the hope of hearing that things will change because of fate or destiny, rather than because of your own actions. Some people keep going to different therapists, buying self-help books, going on retreats, visiting gurus and healers, going on diets or fasts, or searching for a way to feel okay about themselves. We understand this. We did this too. And none of this is wrong in itself, but it's hard to hear the voice inside if you're always looking for your answers outside. You will never be rid of the stuff you don't like, but what if you learn that your flaws are beautiful and you can be friends with them? That's not to say there's anything wrong with wanting to change some behavioural patterns that don't work for you, nor that you shouldn't learn new ways to be and to grow. What we're saying is there's a difference between practicing self-care because you think you're a shitty person who needs fixing, and practicing self-care because you are treating yourself in the same way you would treat someone you love. Think about why you're doing yoga or meditating or exercising or changing your diet. Be honest. Are you trying to fix something? Or can you learn to see that you're perfect as you are, with all your flaws and your beauty? Don't practice self-care to fix yourself. Do it out of a great love and respect for the person you are and the body you live in. What do you like about yourself? Write a list of 3 to 5 things you like about yourself. If you get stuck, think of someone you love and write 3 to 5 things about them instead. See how easy that is? Now think about you again. The first few times you do this, it may feel tricky, but it will get easier. To start you off, here's an example. I care about other people. I like to make people laugh. I am loyal. Now do your own list and see how it feels. Once you've done this, write down 3 to 5 things you have done that make you feel proud of yourself. How to manage the black hole. There will always be some things that trigger you emotionally. It's human nature to experience pain and loneliness and fear. They are part of you. The feeling that you are not enough may always come up, but there is a way to deal with it that will leave you feeling like you are enough. The distinction you want to make is this. It could be you've done something wrong or something has gone wrong, but there is nothing wrong with you. Here's how the process works. Notice when you feel a negative emotion. This may seem strange at first, because you'll be sitting outside your thoughts, looking in on your life. Human beings have what's called negative bias, where we ignore the good stuff and focus on the bad. If you don't notice your negative bias and your reaction to it, your not good enough button gets pressed. So next time you feel an emotional reaction to something someone said or done, first notice it. State it to yourself as clearly as this. Oh, here we go. Watch yourself react. Then notice this. How long does it take from the moment when the feeling is triggered to when it starts to dissipate? An hour? A day? A week? Notice when you try to distract yourself from your dark feeling in your usual way, maybe by shopping, eating, or being bad-tempered with someone you love. Instead, sit with the feeling. It will suck. It will feel awful. But watch it as if you were watching a crap movie. Then notice as it changes and realize it won't last. This does take a load of practice and effort, and you may not be able to do it the first time. We both have to practice this constantly, having businesses that we get publicly reviewed and commented on. We have to learn how to focus on the good stuff and take the negative as constructive criticism, showing us how we could improve. And if it's really hard, why not ask someone you love to give you much-needed perspective? Learning to live with the parts you don't like. Think about the qualities you don't like in yourself. Your anxiety, loneliness, paranoia. It's going to feel strange. But those are the things you need to make friends with. Perfection isn't what makes people attractive. It's your flaws and vulnerability that make you, you. Katia. I'm prone to imposter syndrome. When I start preparing a dinner party for a client, or if I'm creating new recipes for the cafe, I find myself thinking, this is it. This time, everyone will find out that I can't actually cook. It feels very real. The pressure brings out my insecurity, and then I think I'm an imposter. I started to feel better about it when I read that it's very common with successful women. That means I might be successful, right?
Nadia. I used to get super sad when bad things happen, and I'd be afraid I couldn't shift it. But once I accepted that sadness is part of my makeup, and I worked on how to look after myself during these bouts, it became more manageable. Now when that feeling comes, I think, oh shit, here it is. And I get things in place to make it feel softer, not unlike you would if you were dealing with a child who was sad. You would make sure they felt loved and looked after, that they had nice things to do and someone to talk to.
What happens when you truly believe there is nothing wrong with you? Something quite wonderful. You like who you are more, and it shows. People notice it. You feel comfortable in your skin and in your being, and that is a very attractive quality. Being vulnerable is not a weakness. We all have stuff we don't like about ourselves, and when we are able to be open and honest about our vulnerabilities, we realise we are not alone in our feelings. Repeat after me. There is nothing wrong with me. It's time to love your body. I can't overestimate the importance of accepting ourselves exactly as we are right now, not as we wish we were or think we ought to be.
Pema Chodron.
We're not expecting you to fall in love with your body overnight. What we'd like you to do first is notice what you think about yourself when you look in the mirror. Most of us immediately clock something we don't like. Ugh, my ass is too big. I look old. My nose is wrong. Why the fuck is one eye smaller than the other? This is the loop that plays in most people's minds. And we're yet to meet someone who doesn't play a version of that old tune. Being stuck in this groove is not self-care. It is, as you well know, actually being really, really mean to yourself. Would you stand in front of the mirror with your best friend and look at her and say all the things to her that you were saying about yourself? No.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.